Good morning and welcome to Calvary Baptist Church. It is a blessing to worship the goodness of the triune God that He has shown to us in the person and work of Jesus Christ. If you are new with us this morning, we want to specifically welcome you. Thank you for coming and joining us for worship this morning. And also, if you are sitting over here, the sun is probably going to be shining in your eyes a little bit. So I was informed to say if you're doing this, that's okay. And if you are new here, also, we have a QR code at the Connect Desk that you can scan with your camera app on your phone to get connected with us. I invite you all to stand as we hear from the word of the Lord, as we are called to worship Him in spirit and Calvary's hill, we cursed your name. Psalm 47:1-2. Clap your hands, all the people. Shout to God with loud songs of joy. For the Lord, Most High, is to be feared. Great King over all the earth. I will give to the Lord thanks due to His righteousness, and I will sing praise to the name of the Lord.
Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption.
Let's sing together this morning. Praise Jesus. Our Father, Creator, You hold our hearts together. There's no one higher than You. Redeemer, Defender, our great and mighty Savior. There's no one higher than You.
We have a few announcements for you of what's going on here at Calvary. This Thursday is the men's monthly lunch at 11:15 a.m. at Randy's. Please use the Church Center app to register or call the church office to register. On November 13th, the youth group will be packing boxes for Operation Christmas Child. However, in order for us to do that, we need your help. We need items to pack those boxes. And there are wrapped big boxes where you can make your donations by the youth room and by the Operation Christmas Child station there. And we want to see how many boxes we can pack as a youth group. So we encourage you, please donate there so that we can pack boxes as a youth group. For KidsLink volunteers, we will be having a lunch and training starting at 11:30 this Saturday. So please register also through the Church Center app or by contacting Amanda Koppel. Volunteers are also needed for the Children's Ministry check-in desk to open doors and greet families. We are also in need of volunteers in the nursery, toddler, preschool, and kindergarten to third grade classes. If the idea of teaching is intimidating, we are in need of helpers in the older class to help students navigate finding the books of the Bible and encouraging students in the activities. Would you prayerfully consider making a short-term commitment of 5 months, starting in January, of serving once a month in one of these areas? You can find an application in the Church Center app or at the Children's Ministry desk. Please contact Amanda Koppel if you have questions. We have some congratulations that are due to two families. Congratulations to Brandon and Tiffany Garbasiak on the birth of Everett Martin on October 17th. And let's welcome Felix Lazarus to Ben and Hannah Barabo. He was born. He was born at 8 pounds, 9 ounces on Monday, October 25th. Starting today until November 14th, let's bring gifts to bless these two families. The gifts can be put in the chest located in the atrium, which is near the office. There's Hope Gospel Mentor Training that's going to be held on Monday night, November 8th at 6:30 p.m. here at Calvary. Please consider joining this discipleship ministry. I know there's a lot of announcements, but bear with me. We're going through it. The women's Christmas dessert is going to be happening this year. And it's going to be with professional quality desserts, a coffee and hot chocolate bar, apple cider, and a time of encouragement from God's Word. The event is on December 3rd and is for women ages 10 years and up. Register on the Church Center app today. And as a reminder, Daylight Savings Time is next week, where we gain an hour. And if you're one who is normally late, don't bother changing your clock. You'll show up on time. So just a reminder, Daylight Savings Time is next week. And we also want to thank you who have given to Calvary to support our ministries here. We are so grateful for what you have done, and we still encourage you to give. We are thankful for those who give from a joyous heart. At this time, let us pray for the money that has been offered in worship to our God. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the generosity you have instilled in your people to support our local church as well as others who are in need. And we ask that these funds go out as a blessing to many. We pray this in your holy and precious name. Amen. It's a double header, back-to-back prayer. So we will start with several health-related requests. And there's some respiratory illnesses in our body. Pastor Dennis and Jan have been struggling with some respiratory issues, along with Pastor Fred and Sandy, Mike Michaels, and then Scott Deutschlander's brother Mark is hospitalized and on a ventilator with that illness. So we can just continue to keep them in our prayers. And then also, I got notice today that Steve Abraham's 52-year-old cousin is struggling with a type of lymphoma in his abdomen. It's quite serious. Tim is married. He has 3 children, ages 14 through 23. And he's also, to make it a little more complicated, on an anti-rejection medication for a kidney transplant. So we can just continue. He's a strong believer in the Lord, so that's a great hope. But we're also praying for a miraculous healing. We also have, if I can scroll here, Ed Slifer is having some teeth surgery on Tuesday, so you can just pray for just the pulling of those teeth will go well and the healing process with that. And then I would also just like to make a personal request. I have some friends from college that are missionaries in Japan, and his wife found out this week that she has 2 lumps in her breast, and so they're getting a biopsy done. They have 4 young daughters, 2 sets of twin girls, and so we can just continue to pray for them. As they look to the God of hope as they wait in this time. And then the elders and the associate pastor search team are putting the search on hold until February based on some of the leading that they're feeling from the Holy Spirit. So we can just, in this time of pause, just continue to look to the Lord for where he is leading and what that next steps look like. And then finally, you may not know this about me, but I really don't like meeting new people. And if you doubt that statement, Pastor Josh's sister is here, and you can ask about the time that I first met her and her husband. But tonight we have, and with that fear of meeting people, I've always struggled to go with door-to-door evangelism or think through of ways to creatively reach my neighborhood. And I've also often thought, wouldn't it be great if my neighbors would just come to me, ring my doorbell, and ask to receive something? And you know what? I think we have that opportunity tonight. Many of us will have. And I know of a few people that have already thought through some strategic ways to present the gospel. And so we can pray that as tonight, those messages will penetrate people's hearts that are maybe searching at this time. So I'll give us a few minutes to pray, and then I'll close us in a word of prayer here. So. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. We thank you, Lord, that you care for us, that these health concerns we have in our present bodies, that you know the outcome. And we just pray and look to you, Lord, for the healing and the provision for each day. And we just do pray, Lord, that this evening and as we go about our days, that we will be quick to share to proclaim the excellencies of him who called us out of darkness and into your marvelous light. We just pray all these things, Lord, in your precious and holy name, the name that is above all other names, the name of Jesus. Amen.
Please stand with us this morning. Through the storms, through the battles, we can praise the name of our Father. Praise the name of Jesus. Through all those things that are going on in our life, we praise you, Jesus.
Cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled. see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down.
No turning back. I'm not sure if all of you know it or not, but you just sang scripture. Listen, Philippians chapter 3. Finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you is no trouble to me and is safe for you. Look out for the dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh, for we are the real circumcision who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. Though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh, if anyone else thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Can you sing that one more time? That chorus. Can you do that one more time? And remember, you are proclaiming to Jesus Christ in worship exactly what his scripture tells us. You count all things as loss except to know Jesus Christ. And knowing you, Jesus, there is no greater thing. Father, we give you this time to bring us into conformity to the word that you have given us, to know you above all else. In the name of the one we long to know, Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. Unless you have children to take to Discover Link, you may do that now. Well, I so much appreciate the way that the Lord and the Holy Spirit direct the entire ministry of worship in a service, whether it's the worship of opportunities to serve the Lord, the worship of prayer, the worship of giving, the worship of serving, the worship of singing and magnifying the name of Jesus, and now the worship of surrendering our hearts to what the Holy Spirit will teach us through the authority of His Word, the Word of God. We're in Philippians, a study that began back in September called Joyful, Passionate, and Humble Living. And as Pastor Josh has done so well to do up until this point, to give you the idea that everything has built to a central point in the book of Philippians, that now everything after this is going to go back and be somewhat of a repetition of what has already been laid as we work toward a final conclusion. And one of the overall themes that has been significant in our understanding of Philippians is the theme of rejoicing. And Paul begins this third chapter of Philippians with a challenge to all of us to rejoice in the Lord. We're going to walk through this morning, these first 11 verses of chapter 3. We're going to walk through this in a very simplistic outline that will be on the screen, and there's not going to be a lot for you to pay attention to, because as I just digested everything in these 11 verses this week, I've been overwhelmed with the magnitude of the truth that God wants us to understand today. And I don't want to be bound to an outline, even though there will be some points that you can mark down for yourself. In the first verse, Paul uses a word to introduce this by saying, finally. I don't want you to get the idea that this is the same Greek word that is used in English context by a pastor when he gets to point 4 and then goes on for 20 more minutes. That's not what you mean or what you think he means when he says finally. What Paul is saying here is that now that we've laid some foundations of things, it's time for me to make my final points of emphasis. And I want to begin with this one for you. It's for you to rejoice in the Lord. To rejoice in the Lord. Now, if you were to go back to the beginning of the book of Philippians, you would find a total of 7 or 6 references to rejoicing or joy that Paul has already laid, and you would discover that every one of those references to rejoicing is based on a response we make to one of the products of the gospel at work in our lives or in the world. In other words, it's a cause and effect relationship. The rejoicing that takes place in the first 2 chapters is always connected to something that Paul says has happened. Let me remind you of what they are. In chapter 1, verse 4, Paul says, I always pray in every prayer of mine for all of you, making my prayer with joy because of your partnership in the gospel. Paul was rejoicing because he was recognizing the partnership of these people in the gospel. Cause and effect. In verse 18 of chapter 1, it says, what then? Only that in every way, as he has talked about how the gospel is being preached, whether it's from pure motives or from false motives, he says, in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed, and in that I rejoice. Cause and effect. The gospel was being presented. He rejoiced. The next one in chapter 1, verse 25, Paul says, convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy in the faith. Cause and effect. You're progressing in the faith, therefore you can have joy. Cause and effect. Look at chapter 2, verse 2. It says, Paul says, complete my joy by being of the same mind. Here we have the joy of peace in the church because of the gospel of Christ. That as people get along and we're unified in a common goal, cause the common goal that we should have in the gospel. The result, we're joyful with each other, even when sometimes we don't like each other very well. because the cause of joy is not whether we like each other. The cause is we're working together to serve the gospel of Jesus Christ. In chapter 2, verse 18 is the next reference to joy that Paul has in Philippians. And it says this, "Likewise, you also should be glad and rejoice with me." What's the context there? Paul says, you know what? I have poured my life into you. I have poured my ministry into you. And I know it's not in vain because I see you following what the gospel has taught you to do. And even though my life is coming to an end and my life is being poured out as a drink offering and I'm not going to be around much longer, rejoice with me that my labor was not in vain. Cause and effect. There's one more. In chapter 2, verses 28 and 29, what Pastor Josh preached on last week, "I am the more eager to send Epaphroditus to you, that you may rejoice at seeing him again, and that I may be less anxious, so receive him in the Lord with all joy, and honor such men." Cause and effect. Right relationships with each other in the body of Christ cause us joy when we get to see each other again. Every one of the previous references to rejoicing was all about the context of cause and effect. Here's how the gospel's at work. Here's how you can rejoice. Now Paul says, let's bring this to a climax here. Finally, here's the underlying foundational principle you have to understand about rejoicing. It's all based on the gospel itself. Paul moves from emphasizing the effects of the gospel and why we can rejoice to rejoicing in the essence of the gospel, which is Christ himself. And the next 11 verses totally transfix our attention on Christ himself and Christ alone, apart from all of the other residual effects that come from knowing the gospel. We focus on Christ alone. And that's what Paul is going to tell us in the next 10 verses. And he tells us, I don't want you to get tired of hearing some of the same things over and over again. If you're going to learn to rejoice in the Lord, in the fact of Christ and your salvation, without any of the other benefits, take everything else away. Is Christ enough, as you sang this morning? Is Christ enough for you, for me? Take everything else away. And Paul says this in verse 1, "To write the same things to you is no trouble to me, and it's safe for you." Pastor, when are you going to quit talking about the gospel and let's talk about politics, or let's talk about how we respond to this thing going on in culture or this thing in financial management? When are you going to stop talking about the foundation of Jesus Christ? What? Paul reminds the Philippian people, please don't ever get tired of the repetition of the foundation. Christ alone is our focus. And he says, if Christ alone is our focus, you've got to be aware of what the enemies of Christ are doing. You need to be aware of all of the subtle and many times not so subtle ways in which the enemy of our faith, Satan himself, is devising schemes and methods in order to draw you away from trusting Christ alone. And so Paul is going to caution us to beware of the enemies of faith. It's not the only time Paul cautioned us of such things. If you were to turn over to 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 3 and 4, you would hear Paul talking to the church at Corinth about false apostles and false prophets, and he would say these words, "I'm afraid that as the serpent deceived Eve by his cunning, your thoughts will be led astray from a sincere and pure devotion to Christ. For if someone comes and proclaims another Jesus than the one we proclaimed, or if you receive a different spirit from the one you received, or if you accept a different gospel from the one you accepted, you put up with it readily enough. What a tragic statement Paul makes about the church at Corinth. They have allowed the infiltration of things that draw away from the truth of Christ to take on significance within their body fellowship. And Paul says, you're readily being persuaded by such things. And Paul says, I need to repeat to you the foundations of the gospel so you can stand on it alone. And then he uses some very strong language. Verse 2. Look out for the dogs. Paul turns to name calling. Justifiable name calling, because he's about to address us all in the context of the primary source of our faith being led away. And that is by people that teach that salvation comes by your good works. He's about to teach us that the people who would have us understand that our efforts to earn the approval of God are somehow valid before God, those people are dogs. Why would he choose that word dogs right there? Here's why. Because those same people that he's about to refer to, they were called the Judaizers. They were Jewish people who tried to combine the Jewish rite of circumcision and obedience to the law with the gospel of by faith alone in Jesus Christ. They tried to combine those two things. And the people who did not accept that, the Gentiles, who would come into the city of Jerusalem and in their poverty state or whatever would just go anywhere they wanted to go and they would eat anything they wanted to eat, and many of them would even pick up refuse out of garbage that was left over that was unacceptable for the Jews to eat, and the Gentiles would eat it just like the dogs in the city would eat that kind of stuff when they wandered the streets, and they didn't care what they were eating. If there was a scrap of something on the ground, they just gobbled it up. And the Gentiles in their culture said, what we eat doesn't matter. And you know what the Jews' name for the Gentiles was? Dogs. And so here's Paul. He says, let's look at who the real dogs are. Who are the people who are truly perverting the gospel? Not the Gentiles, but you Jews who claim that to come to Christ, you have to add works to your faith. And Paul calls them dogs. And he calls them dogs for three reasons he lists. Look out for the dogs, because dogs don't care about purity. The Gentiles didn't care about purity. They didn't care whether that food had been properly cleansed or just pick it up and eat it. Last night, my grandson had the privilege of shooting a nice 8-point buck in his first bow hunt of the season. And that was pretty cool. And he had this really nice camera that he could, no. And and we were cleaning that deer out in the field. And well, I was cleaning the deer out in the field. Had my arm up inside it and pulling all of that stuff out, you know. And you want a better definition or description? Anybody need more information than that? Some of you are going, yeah, yeah. The youth are all going, yeah, give it to us. And so as we drag the deer away, with blood still trailing out of the back of the deer, there's this pile of innards. And my son Jason as we walked away, said, "The coyotes will eat well tonight." Dogs. Dogs. And if you're feeding your, I'm putting it in air quotes on purpose, spiritual life by serving yourself the value of works to earn the favor of God, you are no better than that coyote eating that gut pile. Dogs. Because you don't care about purity, the purity of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And not only are dogs not caring about purity, but they're also evildoers. Evildoers. They do this on purpose, knowing the truth. Knowing the truth, but for the sake of personal gain and benefit, they gladly pursue what they believe assists them in building their own value. And Paul calls them evildoers. And then he says, look out for those who mutilate the flesh. You all know what this refers to. It refers to the rite of circumcision. Paul uses an interesting word here. The English translation for our word for circumcision, or for the Greek word for circumcision, of course, is circumcision. We all know what that means. Okay, that's our English word. Paul uses a Greek word here for mutilate that the English translation of it is concision. Concision. Making the same incisions, but with no concern to do it with regard to what's around it. Circumcision is an incision with a concern for what's going on around it, carefully done within the context of what is beneficial. Concision is a haphazard cutting with no real purpose. And Paul says these people are of the concision, mutilators of the flesh. Paul cautions us to beware of such enemies of the faith, and he's going to go into more detail in a moment. Reading on, verse 3. For we are the real circumcision. There's the contrast between the mutilators and those who are truly of Christ. For we are the real circumcision. And then he defines the characteristics of true Christianity. If you ever get into a debate with anyone about what a true Christian is, here's three simple principles in one verse that Paul gives us to define whether or not you know you are truly a believer according to the purity of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Here they are. Number one, who worship by the Spirit of God. Who worship by the Spirit of God. Worship today has deteriorated in many churches. It's deteriorated into an emotional appeal for you to gain the Spirit of God. And the proof of gaining the Spirit of God is all the emotion that goes with it. If I can get motivated by the lyrics of that song and the quality of the music that's being done on stage, if I can somehow get so engrossed in that that just for a moment, I'll forget I'm a Baptist and I'll raise my hand. Oh boy, I found the Spirit. Paul says, the true mark of a Christian is when worship starts, you're already in the Spirit. Because you can't worship unless you're doing it by the Spirit, not as a means of gaining the Spirit. Mark of a true Christian. Secondly, Paul says, we glory in Christ Jesus. And you might add the word alone. You glory in Christ Jesus alone. It's not about Jesus and me working together, and at some point I get to somehow attribute some of what gets done to my efforts. It's not about that. Glorying in Christ alone means that I have brought nothing to this partnership, and that I don't bring anything to this partnership that is of any value. If I have anything that Jesus can use in this partnership of the gospel, it's because he gave it to me. So as I'm using it, I'm giving him the glory for allowing me to have the privilege to use it for his glory. And subtly, the dogs of the purity of the gospel of Jesus Christ reach into our churches and into our hearts, and they tell us, wait a minute, Pastor, don't we get some credit? No. We get no credit. I do not stand here today because there is anything in me to present to you anything of value. It is only by the Spirit and through the Spirit and for the Son's glory that you are hearing what you hear today straight from the heart of God. Christians glory in Christ Jesus alone. And then he says, Christians put no confidence in the flesh. Here's the hinge point of what Paul is saying about the dogs. They put confidence in themselves to be able to earn the approval of God. And he's going to list all the ways that if Paul did that, that he would be superior to all of them in earning the favor of God. And in every one of them, there is a lesson for each one of us about what it means to sacrifice self-exaltation for the sake of glorying in Christ alone. Listen to the confidence in the flesh that Paul claims he could have had. Though I myself, he says, verse 4, have reason for confidence in the flesh also. In other words, I could stand in conversation with any one of those Judaizers that are trying to infiltrate the church with works. I could stand next to any one of them and proclaim, I'm more qualified than you are. And here's what his qualifications are. He could trust his rituals better than anybody. I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh. If anyone thinks he has more, I have more. I was circumcised, verse 5, on the 8th day. The ritual of circumcision in the Jewish faith, in the Old Testament faith, was if you were born of a Jewish woman, born of a Jewish father, you have the imputed heritage of the Jewish faith given to you, and therefore, on the eighth day, you are qualified to be circumcised, to make you a covenant member, which is only a ritual to verify that it was granted to you by your birth, by your parents, who were both Jews. Anybody, well, I won't ask the question because I know it's true. Many of you, my wife included, were raised in a religious system where your righteousness was imputed to you by a ritual of infant baptism, and that you claim a standing before God right now that honors you with eternal life because you were baptized as an infant. And Paul says, I could claim that ritual. I was circumcised on the eighth day. That's me. I could claim that. Paul says Christians also don't trust ethnicity or heritage. He says, I was of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. He's going to tell us that we can't trust ethnicity, we can't trust heritage, and we can't trust rank or status, and we can't trust traditions. Paul says, look, I was born of the tribe of Benjamin, significant tribe in the history of Jerusalem. You realize, of course, that the city of Jerusalem resides in the boundaries of the territory of the tribe of Benjamin. So that when the king comes back, their Messiah comes, he has to live within the context of the tribe of Benjamin. And Paul says, I was a member of that tribe. I have more status than anybody. I have more rank. I have better heritage. And then he says, as to zeal, I was a persecutor of the church. As to righteousness under the law, I was blameless. In other words, he says, Christians, we cannot trust rule-keeping to earn our status before God. And Christians, we cannot trust passion to serve God as an evidence that we are truly saved, because who had more zeal to protect the religious traditions of the church, of the Jewish faith, than Paul did, because he went out and he actually killed people who opposed it? Who had more zeal? Who had more passion? Your passion is not an indicator of whether or not you're truly walking with Jesus or not. And Christians, do not live under obedience to the law as their context of faith. Oh, every day I try more and more and more to obey more and more of what God tells me to do. Would you do me a favor and stop trying and just embrace the Holy Spirit of God and let Jesus live his life through you, and you won't ever have to try again to obey a law, because when his love comes through you, you'll automatically obey all his laws. Quit making a big deal out of it. Just surrender to Christ alone. And Paul says, everybody who emphasizes all of these things, and I had the right to, Paul says, everybody who emphasizes all of this, you're a dog. Sorry if that offends you. Those aren't my words. Paul says, anybody who stands opposed to the truth of the foundation of the gospel, that salvation is in Christ alone, by faith in Christ alone, and what Christ does for me, not what I do for him or to meet some religious requirement, anybody who teaches anything other than Christ alone is a danger to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And then Paul says at the end of this, saying, I could have said all of those things gave me my qualification. Verse 7, but whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. Let me help you with something here a moment. Basic Bible interpretation. Only apply verses within the scope of the context in which they're written. This verse has nothing to do with sacrificing your car for the sake of knowing Jesus. This verse has nothing to do with considering everything in your life of any value out here as being rubbish compared to knowing Christ, so that you set up this comparison game of whether or not you have the right clothes or not the right clothes, or the right boyfriend or girlfriend, or the right husband or wife or family structure or whatever. All of that stuff that you go, I'm just working harder every day trying to make sure that Christ means more than all of those things. That's not the context here. Don't use this verse to apply to that. Paul says this verse applies to one context. Anything that you believe about your life that earns the value of God so that he will recognize more of you or consider you better in some way because you do this or have this, because it gives me a better standing with God, that's all rubbish. It's refuse. It's a gut pile eaten by dogs. And we do it all the time, my friends. We do it all the time. Oh, I bet God was really happy today because I was 5 minutes early for church. Now, if I said right there that he didn't care, then next week you're going to be 5 minutes late and expect me to say the same thing, that he didn't care. So I'm not going to do that. What's that? It'll take effort next week, yeah. If you set your clocks back, you're going to be an hour and 5 minutes early. The point is this. You know in your heart, as I do, what things you do every day motivated by this insane, intense spirit of Antichrist within us that says, I need more from God and he'll only give it to me if I do more for God. Satan himself deceiving you because Christ is enough. And you already, in your salvation by faith alone, have him all. He has granted you, according to Paul in Ephesians chapter 1, every spiritual blessing from on high. He has given you everything you need to live a life of purity and godliness, according to Peter. You don't have to work anymore for anything from Jesus. And Paul considers all personal gain as loss compared to knowing Christ. He had lots of personal gain. Man, he was famous in the Jewish culture and in the church. He was famous. If they would have had TV back then, he'd have been on TV every week. He'd have been live streamed all over the place because Paul was everybody's religious hero. And yet he gained it all, the recognition and the identity, by all the wrong motives. And he said, I want to wipe all of that away, and it's all loss. It's done. And then finally, Paul says, finally, I meant that. He says, I want to know him, verse 10. I want to make sure that my righteousness comes from him, not from my obedience to the law. I want to make sure that my righteousness is based on faith alone and not on works. That's verse 9. And I want to make sure that I know him and the power of his resurrection by sharing his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Let me help you again with interpretation. Paul is not saying there, by any way of putting all these things together and me doing them, somehow I'll earn the resurrection from the dead. That's not what he's saying. Paul says, I will attain the resurrection of the dead in one of two ways. I will either be raptured because I'm still alive, or I will be resurrected because I've already fallen asleep in Christ. Either way, my goal is to put everything to death except knowing Christ. So that whether I live or die, Christ is enough. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the exposition of this passage of Scripture. And I pray that some of the harsh words that Paul used in here would not be offensive to us because they may not be politically correct to say out in public. We would never walk up and down the street calling people dogs and mutilators. But within the body of Christ, we must address it the way Scripture does. And within this body of Christ, whether present in this building or watching out there by live stream somewhere, within this body, there are those who are still putting in their own effort to try to earn more approval from you, to earn more acceptance from you, because they don't yet trust faith alone in Jesus Christ. Building their lives on foundations that are shaky and will soon crumble. Because none of our works is of any value to you. None of the church's organized traditional religious works are of any benefit to our value in eternity. Only Christ. And today, Lord, there may be someone, as we sing this last song, who says, I need to be able to say this. I really want in my heart to be set free from the efforts I put in to try to earn God's approval. And I want to just have sufficient faith to say, Jesus, you died for me. You rose from the dead to guarantee my eternal life. And whether I can figure anything else out or not is irrelevant. I simply put my faith in Jesus. And if that's you, while we stand and sing, would you just walk to the front and meet me at the front? And if more than one of you come, there's other elders that are watching, and they'll come up and they'll meet you also. And we will pray over you to, by faith alone, build your life on Jesus Christ alone. Please stand.
Amen. Hallelujah. In the 8th verse, Paul says there's one of two people that are here today, one of two types of people, and you're going to leave in this spirit after you stack chairs. He says, Paul says, for his sake, for the sake of knowing Christ, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ. If you haven't renounced all of your own efforts to earn Christ, you don't have him yet. The only way to have him and gain him is to renounce all your efforts to get him and just receive him because of his effort for you. If you've done that, rejoice in the Lord. If you haven't done that, meet me at the back.
Have a great Sunday. You are dismissed.